Our scripture for this evening comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 23. It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 PM, while the sun's light failed. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, crying out with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." Having said this, he breathed his last.
Here is a litany from Psalm 31. Join me in reading as I will read the regular font, and you all will read the bold. In you, Lord, I have taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame. Deliver me in your righteousness. Turn your ear to me. Come quickly to my rescue. Be my rock of refuge, a strong fortress to save me, since you are my rock and my fortress. For the sake of your name, lead and guide me. Keep me free from the trap that is set for me, for you are my refuge. Into your hands I commit my spirit. Deliver me, Lord, my faithful God. He who hung the earth upon the waters, today he is hung upon the cross. During this time of reflection, we invite you to write down your thoughts and focus on the different images that represent the 7 last words of Jesus.
Several weeks ago, we talked about a novel called The Underground Railroad, and how it has the heroine arrive in a community in North Carolina that has this strange Friday night tradition in the pre-Civil War era. They have a Friday night get-together, which essentially becomes a standing Friday night lynching commitment. And those who have been lynched, their bodies remain in the tree outside of town. It's a form of punishment, in a sense, for some, but in a greater sense, it is intimidation for all who are considering making a run for freedom. You may have seen just a couple of weeks ago, archaeologists uncovered in a small island in the English Channel the remains, the ruins of a Nazi internment camp. And they're starting to uncover more of the history, starting to uncover more of the stories there. And part of one of the stories that they've been told was a person who was hanged in that camp. And the body left on the main gate into the camp with a sign on the chest that said, "For stealing bread." The words on the sign on Jesus' cross carried a far more serious charge: King of the Jews. But there are familiar horrors for what he experienced on the cross. The intimidation of Southern lynchings, the direct messaging of the Nazi hitmen, and as we've discussed so many times, the agony of the cross. This combination of physical pain, psychological torture, relational loneliness, and in the case of a godly Jewish person living in the first century, the theological consideration of shame, this connection between the idea of being punished publicly and the idea of sinfulness in that person's life. Jesus has voiced many of these horrors, as we've already seen in these last several weeks, his words from the cross. He's talked about what it feels like to be forsaken. Forsaken by humanity, but also forsaken as he has experienced it, as many have experienced. Forsaken as if forsaken by the holy God's self. Jesus has talked about what it feels like to live in extreme loneliness, the great isolation that comes on the cross. And yet we have also seen Jesus give voice to the limitless compassion out of which he has lived and ministered, as even from the cross he prays for the forgiveness of all who know not what they are doing, beginning with those who are executing him. Here we find his final words. This is what was on Jesus' mind as he drew his final breath. "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." Father, it's been recorded in many settings that sometimes as people are reaching the end of this life, they go back and are remembering some of their earliest memories from childhood. Could it be that Jesus is remembering what you and I find as our earliest personification of the divine, mommy and daddy? Perhaps he's even remembering the man that he knew as a child as his earthly daddy, Joseph, one of prayer, a person who is a mystic, a dreamer, a provider, a protector. Perhaps Jesus is remembering his face. Of course, Luke's gospel gives us no limit in options of understanding the idea of a father. Here is where we find the great story in Luke chapter 15 of the prodigal son and the elder brother and the righteous father who always stands ready to receive, to welcome home. You and I know Jesus has no need for the Father to extend forgiveness as the righteous Father does at the end of Luke 15. And yet there is something in Jesus' words that seems to suggest he longs to see the one racing out to the end of the drive there on the farm, reaching out, ready to receive him in, ready to receive him home once again. Nevertheless, he longs to be received into the Father's embrace. I commit my spirit. Jesus has been referencing Hebrew scripture on the cross. We've seen a couple of times where Jesus seems to be quoting directly from Psalm 22. Why have you forsaken me? We've looked at that in a number of different places and a number of passages. And now here in Jesus' final words from the cross, he seems to be quoting Old Testament scripture again. He seems to be referencing directly Psalm 31, verse 5. Into your hand I commit my spirit, the psalmist writes in Psalm 31. I commit to you all who I am, all who I have been, and all unfulfilled who I had striven to be within you. All my hopes and dreams, all of this I lay aside and I lay before you. The essence of who I am, I place it before you as I commit my spirit. Or as a man who in a tortured sense is reaching the end of his life, many others in that case would have said it this way: I cannot bear it alone any longer. I cannot bear it on my own. I cannot bear it without your divine help. I commit my spirit, needing someone to carry it for me. To your hands. To your hands. Psalm 31, verse 5 continues, you have redeemed me, O Lord, faithful God. Redeemed. Faithful. These are Hebrew terms as well that speak to what Christ may be experiencing on the cross. Redeemed. Whatever physical struggles in the garden that Jesus experienced, whatever spiritual struggle of spiritual isolation, Jesus knows the presence of the Holy is with him even now. Redeemed, not in the sense of forgiveness and reconciliation like you and I would need it, but redeemed in the sense of recognizing the presence of the Holy. Faithful. God is faithful. Even when we do not, cannot, will not see it, God is faithful. Maybe a better way to say it is God is more faithful than our ability to comprehend God's faithfulness. Whatever may come, Jesus seems to say, I would rather it be with you than with anyone or anywhere else. Father, I commit my spirit into your hands. Jesus breathes his last, his body finally succumbing to the instrument of death, selected for this moment and for this purpose by humanity. Creation's ultimate rejection of the Creator is met in this moment with the Creator's ultimate embrace of creation. The end will be as the beginning. The three persons of the triune God together, God in three persons, blessed Trinity, and the name shall be called Emmanuel, Creator, Sustainer, Comforter, God with God, God with Son, God with Spirit, God for us, God among us, God in us, God with us, God with us, God with us.
Into your hands I commit my spirit. Those words that we are reflecting on today speak of trust and communion. And it is out of our trust and our deep longing to commune with Jesus that we come to this table today. Now imagine yourself sitting at the table across from Jesus. We are gathered together today separately, but we are joined in spirit by this practice that we share. So also imagine around that table with you and Jesus are your fellow community members, those that you worship with. And then also put at the table those first believers who were with Jesus around that first Lord's Supper table, that Passover table for them. And around your table, you will find that there are many imperfect followers of Jesus, as there are at mine. There are James and John who bring a lot of selfish ambition to the table. Judas contains all of this greed and anger mixed up in him. And there's Peter, who is so self-unaware that he can't even imagine how he is able to fail so big. But he will. And there are others who bring loneliness and worry, jealousies, frustrations with one another. The list of failings goes on. And we are part of that list. But the key, the point, the beauty of our imperfect communion tables is that everyone still gets to participate. No one is refused. No one is kicked out. All are welcome at this table. All are welcome to commune with Jesus. Jesus doesn't require his disciples to be perfect followers. Just to follow, and to do so daily, to try and walk in his steps and speak with his words, and to enter into relationship with him. And so we enter into this Lord's Supper time as a way of being in relationship to Jesus, wanting to follow him even as he walks toward the cross. So we say, as Jesus did, thank you, God, for this meal together. And then as you in your own home gather your bread, whatever you have that is to represent the bread today, and you take and you eat, hear Jesus saying, this is my body broken for you. And as you take your cup and you drink, Jesus says, this is my blood poured out for you. We carry Jesus' sacrifice with us, and we remember.
Oh, how he loves you and me. Oh, how he loves you.
From the cross, Jesus' final words of this life were those words we talked about earlier from Psalm 31. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. We've already talked several times in this Lenten season about how Jesus speaks from Psalm 22 at other places in these last sayings. Psalm 22, of course, is the place that speaks of feeling forsaken, isolated, abandoned. But we noted that that trilogy, the Shepherd's Trilogy of Psalm 22 and 23 and 24, does not leave us in that place of abandonment, but takes us to a place of holy presence in Psalm 23, a place of presence and provision, and then a place of celebration and worship in Psalm 24. Like Psalm 22, Psalm 31 does not end in that place of isolation and hurt either. In fact, Jesus' final words point to the end of the psalm that he is referencing. And I'm going to share those final words of Psalm 31 with us now. Love the Lord, all you, his saints. The Lord preserves the faithful, but abundantly repays the one who acts haughtily. Be strong and let your heart take courage, all you who wait for the Lord. Good Friday, Saturday of shadows, and all who are looking for Sunday to dawn, hear now the word of the Lord. Be strong. Let your heart take courage, all you who wait for the Lord.